Hi, this is Tricia from Interviews from the Edge, and I am on the phone right now with Mike Andrews. How are you doing today, Mike?
I'm doing great, thanks.
Mike has got a new album. It's an album, right? Coming out on August 14th, Spilling a Rainbow?
Yep.
Bridesmaids is one of my favorite movies.
You like Bridesmaids?
That movie was done by Judd Apatow. Did I say his name right? Judd Apatow?
Apatow. Okay. And Paul Feig. You know, Paul Feig directed it. Judd was obviously very involved, but he was a producer, Paul created Freaks and Geeks with Judd.
Yeah.
The other guy.
You scored that one, too.
Yeah, I did the Freaks and Geeks,
I'm in Atlanta, and you know Freaks and Geeks. We are like Dragon Con and...
Yeah, Geek Central in Atlanta.
We'd be like, we're not worthy. We're not worthy.
I like Atlanta a lot. It's a cool spot. California's awesome, too, but, you know, Atlanta's great.
Tell me about Everloving.
Everloving's putting out this record. I've known Andy and JP for a very long time, and they've always been supportive of my stuff. My first solo record I put out on my own. But other than that, Andy has put out almost every record that I've made, you know, because I produce records too. So he put out the Metric album that I produced, my Darko score album, he put out the Mew score album, and now he's putting out this album. He signed me, I had a group on Virgin, and I was his first signing a long time ago, so
We've
known each other forever, and it's really nice because I don't have to explain anything to him. I just give him the music, and he knows.
Well, you are working within a pretty small group. You've known him all this time, and you've got Jake Kasdan, and you guys did Bad Teacher together.
And I work with his wife. You know, I work with his wife, Anna George. I produced her records, and I did her record with Van Dyke Parks. So, I mean, I have a nice little small group of friends, and we make stuff.
You guys have found success together.
Yeah. The film scoring side of my life is very collaborative. And it's a great way to make a living, and it's a great way to keep changing and being challenged and stay writing. Because I think when you get in the world of records with all the sort of sales aspect of it and touring and all that, you know, you end up working a very small repertoire of material over and over again. Whereas in the film world, I just get to write all the time. And I've made so much music in the last 20 years through all my film work. It just keeps that muscle pretty limber. And then when I get to my songs, it makes it a pretty free-flowing experience.
Dude, came in with Freaks and Geeks. It had to blow your mind when that ended so fast because it was like this crazy cult following, and all of a sudden, you know, the network shut it down. I was so mad. I love that show. I could not understand why they would shut that down, because anytime you get into animation, comics, anything geeky, geeks are loyal people. They will buy your shit, okay? They just will.
Thing is back when Freaks and Geeks came out, there weren't all these other smaller stations. There was HBO and Showtime, all these other channels that are playing all these very funny shows, and you're on a network, it's business. When you have 3 million viewers, that's just not enough. A million viewers every week. I don't even remember what it was, but we were threatened to be canceled the whole time. The fact that we made it to the end of the season was incredible. That was a feat. You know, all those guys have done very well. Everybody in the show has done so well, and I see Jason Segel, and I see Seth, and I see a few of the other folks around. And they're all really sweet guys. I keep busy every once in a while. And they're all cool, you know. They were so young when they did that show. I used to go to the set and hang out with them. And they're kids, you know. Now they're like movie stars. It's a trip. Like I said, it's just business. And they're crunching numbers and trying to get advertisers. And when it doesn't work, it doesn't sustain itself.
They
just can't lose the money, you know. Like big record companies that sign interesting bands that don't sell a million records, they need to do the business, you know.
Yeah.
Doesn't mean it's not good.
Well, you know what? They got to keep the doors open, and if you keep betting on horses that aren't going to show, then what are you going to do, you know? After a while, you'll have to shut the doors, and then you won't even have a shot, right? I have mixed feelings about the whole record company thing.
To me, they don't really even exist. I mean, when someone says they're trying to get a record deal, I just laugh. I don't even care. And quite honestly, the large indie labels are pretty similar. It's like high school. It's like, oh, you sit on that bench, and I don't sit on that bench, so I guess I'm going to have to keep on myself. I don't really care. You know, I just make music. I don't really bother with the rest of it.
I want to talk to you about some of the great movies that you've worked on. It blows my mind. You did The 5-Year Engagement, Bad Teacher, Walk Hard. You did the soundtrack for Walk Hard. I love that movie.
Yeah, I produced all the songs, and I wrote the score, and I wrote some of the songs with folks, you know. But I did all that music.
And you've got a movie out right now, The 5-Year Engagement.
5-Year Engagement, I think, is out. Done. I did Jeff Who Lives at Home. I've done a couple movies with the Duplass brothers, Cyrus, and Jeff Who Lives at Home, and I think now I've done like 16 or 18 movies, something like that.
That's amazing, huh? That's a great career. Tell me about the new record that's coming out, Spilling a Rainbow, on August 14th.
On August 14th. It comes out on August 14th. It's a document mostly about my life in the last couple of years, interrupted sort of with, you know, all these movies that I did. You know, I sort of did it during the time that I was doing Bridesmaids and Bad Teacher and Jeff Lives at Home and 5-Year Engagement. So I've been quite busy. So I tried to fit it in between that. And then I had a child during that time. That sort of shifted my world a little bit. And I kind of documented what I was going through and how my life was changing. And that's kind of about what the record is, you know. It's a record about having a kid and experiencing, you know, that thing.
Well, that has to be kind of cool. Because, I mean, when you're doing a movie, something, it's you're focusing on what's happening to somebody else. And now you're getting to express yourself. So it had to be a joy to make the record.
Yeah, it's definitely a really fun thing to do. Yeah, I enjoy making my own records. I don't do it very often, and it's always a pleasure to spend some time just doing whatever I want to do, you know. I think you can preview some of the tracks on iTunes, and I think there's a video for the song Bubbles in Space. I'm going to do a residency here in L.A., continue to do some collaborations with Folks Live. I'm sort of like curating the bootleg in L.A.
Oh, that's cool. That'll be fun.
Yeah,
you get to be music guy instead of movie music guy, huh?
I guess, for a minute, yeah.
But I guess that's kind of good because it lets you, you know, explore creatively in different ways. And plus you're with people that you get along with. And those guys must be fun to work with. How crazy is it when you guys are working together?
It's not that crazy, honestly. It's pretty much like we're trying to get it done, you know. It's pretty simple. It's a great time, but it's a lot of work. A lot of work to make a movie and distill it into something. You know, these movies during the process are just morphing continually, and so the music is continually changing. I did 20 people. I think I did like 175 pieces of music for that movie.
Oh my God.
Yeah, so they don't end up in the movie, but you know, maybe there's 20 or 25 pieces of music that end up in the movie. I didn't just make what you hear in the movie. I make a lot of stuff that is in the movie for a little while, and then they cut the scene, and so the music goes out, or I make a piece of music, and it's not quite right, so I have to do it again, and I do that, you know, 5 or 6 times, or sometimes 10 times, or whatever.
Yeah, I would imagine that it would change a lot, too, because when you go and you're looking at a script, there's not a person playing that character.
I don't even start writing at the script stage. I just enjoy the script, and I wait to see the picture. There might be some people that write to the script, but I don't do that. I mean, I don't do that very often. Walk Hard, we had to do that, obviously, because they had to shoot all the music, but most of the time, music, you know, with the visual and the dialogue, rhythm of the dialogue and all that, it really determines what the music is going to be for me. It's very much a part of what inspires me to make the music.
Well, I'll tell you what, that movie, you're looking at it and you're going, like, his brother died, and then he was singing the song because his brother died. I don't even know where these guys come up with this stuff.
Walk Hard is incredibly farcical, yeah. It's pretty awesome. I love Walk Hard.
Oh, my God. To me, it's brilliant. But, you know, I have a real gallows sense of humor anyway, so the darker the comedy, the more I like it.
Well, it was even darker in its earlier stages. It kind of lightened up as it went along.
Was it really?
Oh, God, it was really dark. It was really funny and incredibly dark. I haven't actually watched the DVD, the extended sort of DVD, but I'm sure a lot of that stuff is on there. But yeah, it was really dark. You know, the story of an incredibly narcissistic guy, you know, so it got very dark.
All of theirs are kind of like that. You've got these people that, you know, are in their own worlds, and that's the only thing that's really important. And then worlds collide, and they're forced out of their holes or whatever, you know.
Yeah, right, yeah.
I think everybody sees a little bit of themselves in most of their comedies, you know, or at least somebody they know.
Yeah, for sure. I mean, everything in those movies is based on a real event, you know, whether it be like part of Judd's life or Jake's life or Paul's life or Jason. Movies are highly improvisational, and so they all come from a real place, you know, even though the result is comedy, it's all coming from a real spot, you know.
You did the score on one of my favorite movies of all time. I mean, ranking in the top 5, it may well be my favorite movie of all time, Donnie Darko. That movie was, though, you want to talk about a dark movie and a strange movie, but you know what? I was surprised how many people love that movie. I mean, you know, you've got the whole rabbit thing going on and everything. It goes a little deep. most people wouldn't get it. That's what I thought.
Well, you know, I mean, the thing that's great about that movie, it's very open to interpretation, that movie. And honestly, I feel like even the people involved in the movie were a little uncertain about what it was about, you know. I think it's an interesting movie. It's definitely had a million lives, and I've been fortunate to be involved with a lot of projects that have had multiple lives, so I feel fortunate.
Well, you know, I think that movie, that's like on all my profiles as my favorite movie. That and Spinal Tap.
Yeah.
I'm that kind
of... Yeah, I mean, people really dig
but
it, you know.
The kids always say something about it. It speaks to me at my age, to them. I mean, everybody gets something out of it, and I think it's really cool to have something that's going to last that long, and you are a part of that. Your music had so much to do with that, because you know what? The atmosphere of that movie is what made it.
Yeah. I think between me and the poster, the guy who was the cinematographer, I mean, we definitely gave the movie its vibe, you know? But, you know, movies are like that, you know. I think there's just an uncontrollable, very unpredictable thing that happens or doesn't happen when you're making a movie. You know, the magic is it either happens or it doesn't happen, and I think in that case, the movie, however ambiguous it is, seems to capture a magic that's rare, you know. So it's like any kind of art, you know. So a lot of it has to do with everything aligning and something happening that's special and that can endure.
Did you feel it when you guys were doing that?
You know, I really enjoyed it. I really enjoyed making the music. You know, it was the first film that I ever did, really, as a composer on my own. So yeah, I mean, it was challenging and scary and really rewarding, you know. It's really a good time.
Yeah, it's a great movie. And it's one of those movies that if I could have watched it, and if they play it back to back, I'll watch it twice. You know, I can't turn off the TV when it comes on. And I've got a copy of it on a DVD, and I still, if it's on the TV, still watch it. So
that's cool.
It is. I love that movie. And I'm going to have to link that one so that folks can pick it up, because if there's anybody out there that hasn't seen Donnie Darko yet, you've got to get that movie. You've got to watch it, and you've got to watch it twice. Because the first time you watch it, you can't put everything together until it starts getting to the end. And then it's just one of those movies that, like The Usual Suspects, except for like a psycho weirdo, Usual Suspects.
But when
you get to the end of the movie, you go, oh, wait a minute. And then you're hitting the rewind button to go back and look at all this stuff.
Yeah, I know, right. Yeah, it's confusing. It's definitely confusing.
Until it ties everything up at the end. And then you're like, you're like, oh, wait, let me go back and watch all that. It's kind of cool. And you also produced the record for Gary Jules, and he did Mad World.
Yeah, I've been working with Gary since I was a little kid. Yeah, I mean, we did Mad World for the movie, for the end of the movie, and then they moved it up to that montage. It was originally made for the end title, and there was a U2 song on the montage, and then they couldn't afford the U2 song, so we ended up putting Mad World on the montage, and it just sort of, again, was a very chance event that happened to, like, really hit home. It was pretty amazing.
Yeah. You guys did a beautiful version of that.
Yeah, this is Here's the Fear song that was off their first album, The Hurting, and I was a big fan of that record when it came out. Yeah, so that's a good idea to do that song. But, you know, they had a song in the movie previously and sort of thought it would be cool to do a version of a song from that era that was not at all, you know, sort of that, you know.
Well, you know what? You guys own that song now. I mean, in everybody's hearts and minds.
Yeah, no, you know what? It's been a great thing, and I think that it's helped fuel Gary's career. And it's just been cool, you know. It's good to continue to be part of, like, the cultural fabric. And anytime you add a little piece to that, it's a cool thing, you know.
It plays around here, and everybody stops. Everybody goes, Donnie Darko.
Gary sang it, so he gets a lot of the questions about it and a lot of the sort of adoration. But, yeah, I mean, you know, a lot of people like Donnie Darko. A lot of people ask me about it. And, you know, it's cool. It's cool.
Well, you did Freaks and Geeks and then turn around and did Donnie Darko. You know, these are not two things that you want to do back-to-back if you want to make it in Hollywood, if you want to be composing for movies, but you proved yourself.
I'm just here making music. I never tried to do or be anything. So, you know, I was fortunate to, like, make something that struck a chord with people, and I just keep making stuff. So it's like, I'm not here climbing the ladder.
You just want to sit down on the ladder. You're okay where you are on the ladder. And that's, you know what? That's a good place to be, my friend. Especially when you just had your baby.
I'm not looking to, you know, have some sort of industry.
You're not waiting for your big breakthrough?
Making music in my garage, basically.
I'm sure people still think you're weird. It's just the It's like, look at all your choices.
You know, I mean, you know, I haven't really changed my vibe. It's just the movies have gotten more popular, you know, so.
Yeah.
So that's cool.
Well, yeah, you were always kind of like an indie guy and indie music when there was no indie. You were a little ahead of your time, and now now you're cool. Back then they were like, he's weird.
I don't know. Like I said, I'm just doing my thing, and happy if people want to listen to it and watch it. And if not, I just, you know, I have my studio. I'll just keep doing it, and that's that. Yeah,
you're making music at your house, right?
Yeah, you know, I'm sort of like a weird, like, gear collector kind of person, so I've been collecting gear since I was a kid. I have cobbled together quite an awesome studio, and, you know, collected a bunch of instruments that have been on tour, you know, over the last, I don't even want to say it, it'll expose my age, but 25 years, something like that. So, you know, I've got a bunch of shit, and I got a lot of old keyboards and guitars and weird recording devices, and, yeah, I built a few studios, and you know, built a studio in almost every house I've lived in since like 1992, mm-hmm. and I just work out of my house usually.
Yeah, you are weird then. Okay, you are a geek. You're in there with all your stuff. I'm like,
you know, I have to tell you that when I went in to meet with, it's so funny, when I went in to meet on Freaks and Geeks, they thought I was there for casting. They thought I was there for casting when I went in.
That's funny. Yeah, you would fit in.
And I am in the episode. I'm with the band for Super Freaks and Geeks trivia people.
There you go. Yeah.
You see me on episode whatever 17 or whatever.
You'll have to do a giveaway. If we get a chance to do that, we have to hook something up with Howard. And if people can find where you are on Freaks and Geeks, then you'll give them a free download of your album. How's that? the first person, not all of them are. It'll definitely get the YouTube views on Freaks and Geeks up, won't it? YouTube will thank you for that.
Yeah, I have been recognized from Freaks and Geeks. So I was at like a Pete's Coffee one time, and someone was staring at me. I was like, "What's up with this person?" And he came up and said, "Were you at Freaks and Geeks?" I was like, "Yeah." It's not funny.
That is so great.
It's a funny world.
It is. Well, you've had an amazing life. You really have.
Yeah, I do. I feel very fortunate.
I'm probably going to have to let you go because I know we've been on the phone for quite a while, and I'm going to cut most of my side chatter and yakking out. They just want to hear you. They don't really, they hear me all the time.
No, you know what? I want your chatter in there too. That's the best part.
Well, just not as much. I have a very big mouth. People are always saying, that woman annoys me. Why won't she shut up so I can hear him? they don't appreciate me, man. Well, I want to thank you so much, Mike, for joining me today. But before I let you go, I wanted to make sure I gave you an opportunity to send a message out to your fans. Would you like to send a message out to them?
Yeah, thanks for following my diverse and confusing career, all 12 of you.
That's funny.
All right.
That's kind of what my profile says. I have 2 readers, and they follow me diligently. All right, now you've got another movie that's not ready to come out yet.
I just finished a Mira Nair movie. You know, she did Monsoon Living in Salaam, Bombay. She's an Indian, independent Indian filmmaker. She's amazing. And, yeah, we just finished the spoiler mixing out now, and it'll go to all the festivals and whatnot. And then I'm doing a new show with Jake for television, that Ben and Kate show, and I've got a new movie with Paul Feig that's about to start.
Any names? You gonna give me any titles here so I know where to look for you and go get the soundtrack?
Well, the Mira Nair movie is called The Reluctant Fundamentalist. Paul's movie is called The Heat with Melissa McCarthy and Sandra Bullock, and Ben and Kate is going to be on right before New Girl. So.
Wow.
It's also a Jake production.
I'm surprised you had time to make a baby. I'm just going to leave that hanging, okay? We're going to leave it. I can't believe you've done that much work. I mean, you've done, like, in the last 5 years, you did more than you did all those years before.
Not necessarily, because you're not including all the records that I made, because I made Great White All-Stars records, I made an R. George records, I made a Charlie Wadhams record, I made, you know, I've just been very low-pro, you know? I'm always in my studio every day making music, so somewhere is coming out. Also, I have, you know, like 3 records in my studio now that are ready to come out, but I just haven't put them out yet, so.
Oh, my God.
There's a lot in the works.
You are a geek, dude. I'm telling you. I know you don't believe me, but, I mean, you know, it's like what, you know, my brother used to do the computer thing all the time. And I was like, what are you doing in there? Who could spend, you know, 12 hours messing around with computers? But that's the way you are with your music.
Well, really. Totally. When it's like when you love what you do, you just do it, you know?
Yeah, and you get involved in it. That's the way I am about writing, though. You know what? I hit a zone, and I don't even realize how much time has gone by. Yeah. I'm not even, you know, I'm in my head. You're not touring right now, right?
Well, I'm gonna do my residency in LA in August, and then I'm gonna see what happens from there. You know, it's I've got a lot going on, and in my film world, so I'm gonna see how people react to the record. If there's a demand for me to come out and play, I'll do it probably. But as of now, I'm not planning on. There's nothing in the works, but I'm open to the idea.
Okay, well, if you come to Atlanta for Dragon Con, because mm-hmm. I think you should. I think it would be really, really awesome to have you here, and I will take you there myself. Have you ever been to Dragon Con?
No, I haven't.
Oh my God, you'd be such a rock star there, you know that?
All right, well, maybe I'll have to cruise down there.
I'm telling you, I think you would have a blast. I think you'd be looking at laughing and not realizing how much you had impacted all these kids with everything from Freaks and Geeks and Donnie Darko. I mean, everything that you've done and continue to do. But uh-huh. I'm going to go ahead and let you go. The album is called Spilling a Rainbow. It comes out on Everloving on August 14th. And hopefully I'll get a chance to talk to you again after the album comes out, okay? So we can see how it's going.
Great, I'd love to.
All right. I'll talk to you later.
Kicking out with you. I'll talk to you later.
Yeah. You tell him. I said, yeah, I'll give you my video camera and you can go out there and do your own show. I think it'd be
all
cool.
All right. Okay. Sounds good. All right.
I'll talk to you later.
Take care. Take care. Bye.
Bye.